moved by that song. Let's just put your hands together for Jesus. Thank you, choir. I was touching you. You may be gratefully seated. Hallelujah. As you're sitting, just look to your neighbor to the left and to the right. Just welcome them to church. With a warm smile, just tell them, welcome to church. Welcome to church. Hallelujah. Amen. Are we glad to be in God's house? Okay, my assignment here is simple this morning. I trust that God will speak to us. This morning, I'd like you to just prepare your hearts. It's our faith week. I'd like you to be expectant. Pastor, thank you for the opportunity to minister to your people. So quickly, I'll just share a couple of what the Lord laid in my heart, and as I was asked to take the word this morning, I'd like you to be prepared. We'll be looking at the subject of faith, but I'll take it from another dimension because I know so many scholars have dealt extensively in this line. I'll just share briefly what the Lord laid in my heart, and I want you to just be prepared. I know God surely will give us an encounter. So right about now, media, I'd like you to just help me. I'll be speaking on the subject, the perfect faith, a mustard seed. Say it again, the perfect faith, a mustard seed. Of course, I'm sure we all know, we've heard about the story of that, a mustard seed. It could be as tiny as this. Sometimes if you are well endowed, you might need a magnifying glass to be able to see through those mustard seed. And scientists have proven that this seed can just be buried in the ground and grow as far as tall as imaginable. So the size of that seed does not depend on what you see in holding in your hands. You can be holding a nation right in front of your heart. In your thoughts, you can be holding what? The next billionaire. You can be holding the next generation to which God is waiting for. Bible said, the whole world are with what? The manifestations of what? The songs of God. That word is coming from our heart. Not because of you're looking at the point where you are now, but you're looking at the word that is coming right into our heart. And I trust God that's what the Holy Spirit will do this morning, not me, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like you to, media, if you can project the Bible scripture, Matthew 17:20, the NLT version. I want us to just look at this subject. Amen. Wow, hallelujah. Okay. Because of your little faith, he told them, for I assure you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will tell this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible. Amen. I'd like you to underline that he told them. NLT version said, I tell you the truth. So this is the background of the story. Jesus Christ had been with his disciples, and he had given them quite an analogy, and he has taken them through the test of the school of the spirit. And he was expecting that they would do so much more. But here is this man, and ran down to him. And he said, Master, I do not doubt your power, but I've been with your disciples, and they were not able to solve my problem. Why I had to come to you? He does not need to explain that to the master. He can just say, sir, this is my challenges. Help me. But he went further down so that he would not look down as if, yes, he never had the trust in where he was coming from. But he needed to share that thought so that the master can have a compassion on him and say, okay. And then he looked back. He just left the man, and he looked at his disciple, and he said a certain word. We're looking at that Matthew from, I'm taking from 14 down to 20. That's the background of the story. And he looked at them and said, oh, faithless generation and perverse. That was sharp because he was angry. Reason why was because he had given them authority. He had given them instances. He had given them situations where they needed to strengthen what? Their faith. But he couldn't imagine that they were stuck up in the same old ways. In their mind, they are stuck up in their ideology. They were stuck in their what? In their intellectual capability. And he was saying, oh, faithless and what? Perverse generation. Of course, you're talking to a mortal man, and what do you expect? But he wasn't staying from their standpoint, because he said, ye are what? God, here on what? On earth. And he was expecting more. Of course, I wouldn't blame them. And they were shocked. And one of them asked, that's the background. So he said, disciple asked, why can't we? Of course, there are times situations come in life, and then we just run over it. You break into a couple of millions, and you are not asking, Lord, what did I do differently? You are at a position, and you are stuck. And we don't think so. Ask those questions. Why am I here? For what purpose was I built to be here? Of course, we tend to negate those questions and just begin to assume, oh, I think I must have been here for a particular reason. I think where God is not just fair. I think where it's from my family, where I came from, like the man by the pool of Bethsaida, where he had the opportunity to be what lifted, he was said, of course I had no man to lift me. Who's asking you those analogies and all that? Who's asking you for those questions? You are in front of the master, but they were there with him. They were asking, sir, why can't we cast this demon out? And it was a good one. Let me digress a bit. The subject of faith to we Christian, it's a vital role. You know, when Pastor said to me that I can tell Greatman, I want a more deeper understanding. I was wondering, Lord, where will I don't know. I couldn't be in his spine. I kept wondering. Even the one I tried to put up together, thank God, because I was seeing it from my standpoint. But while I was just praying in my usual routine for him, when he approved this particular topic, I didn't know how I was going to go about it. And I was praying for 4 days, and I could not even get a bullet point to write about. And then I was praying in my usual routine at 4 a.m. in the morning, and then the answer started coming. Then I knew God was about to say something. I'm trusting God will share a bit in our hearts this morning, in Jesus' name. So back to the question they were asking, why can't we cast out this demon? Man. And it was truly a question for them, because the subject of faith is very vital. How do you explain to a man that the just shall live by faith? How do you explain? I said, upon Mount Zion, there shall be deliverance and there shall be holiness, and also Jacob shall possess their possessions. Do you know what their possessions are? What if it's a house in Banana Island? Who will bring it from Banana Island down to the mountaintop? Hello? How do you explain to a Virgin Mary that you are going to conceive? And then she came out and said, and then the baby start leaping. How do you explain that? How do you explain? He said, Hebrews 11:6. He said, without faith, it is impossible to what? To please God. How do you explain that? Have you seen him before? Do you know what you can do to please him? Amen. So they needed to ask that question. Why can't we? Amen. When I began to study deep, and I began to ask myself the question as well, did I really even have this faith? Did I even have the size of that mustard seed? I wasn't even looking at the mustard seed again, because it looks so much bigger in my mind already when I began to ask these questions. Of course. Amen. So I began to look I went back to the scripture again. That's in Matthew 17:20. And I'm just wondering. I tell you the truth. If you have faith, even as small as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move. Mountains are not just sands. Mountains are there in Egypt. You don't even know who kept it there. And the Lord is saying, you will say to this mountain, be moved. Amen. So I began to look at the Amplified Version. Can we just look at the Amplified Version of this same scripture? If you're there, media, can you help us? There's a particular scripture the Amplifier just put up, and if we can say there, it said, I'll just read. Your lack of trust and confidence in the power of what? God. You can imagine what it means by that trust and what? And confidence. Are we there? Okay, let me just look at the Amplified version. I'll just read. I don't know, for the sake of time. It was talking about the place of trust and what? And confidence in the power of God. Of course, there has to be a time where you have to throw your intellect aside and begin to put your trust, what? In God. Of course, that's where we are called to be. Faith is just more than just believing. It's entrusting our life to what we believe. How do you entrust your life to what you don't see? Amen. It requires what? Faith. Somebody say faith. It requires your faith. Amen. So I began to look down in the story. So tell me, how did you explain when you sat behind a bus driver and he's taking you to a distance? Who's giving an assurance that yes, he could drive? What makes you give an assurance that his driver license was satisfied? By who? Amen. That's the instance of where we come about what? Faith. I'm just trying to put your thoughts together. Sorry, I'm going to have to disrupt your thoughts for a minute. But let's just go. Follow me. And I began to wonder. Okay, so meaning that, yes, sometimes I took some things down and I just begin to write. From the scripture, sometimes faith seems complicated and confused. Of course, if you agree with me. For me, I just began to wonder. This subject of faith can seems to be what? Confusing. It can seem to what? Be complicated. Because you begin to wonder, how can you say that in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the glory of the Lord? How? How did you see a God who said, yes, we behold him as our what? Our face will change. And we're what? We become light. So you see a picture, image of somebody, and the same thing, you are seeing a mirror. Have you had that together? Are you seeing twice? Are you saying you are seeing a picture face of someone and you are seeing a mirror? How do you explain that? That's talking about what? Faith. Amen. And I began to wonder, say, okay, fine. Okay, yeah, Bible said, let's come boldly unto what? The throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace. How do you explain that? Right front in your house, and he's asking, let's come what? Boldly unto the throne of grace. Amen. So back to the Amplified verse, it was talking about what? Trust and confidence in the power of what? God. That means the faith. Amen. No wonder they were asking the questions. Why can't we what? Dealt with this demon, of course. Amen. Let me just digress a bit. There was a story about Peter, and he was looking at Jesus Christ. And at that point, you can sense that, yes, there's something inside of him was saying that yet you can do it. Because he has seen Jesus walk on the water. And he asked, Master, if it be you, bid me what? To come. How does it make sense when you start? Of course, I've traveled on a flying boat before, but water is not just something you feel that you can step on like a solid. How do you explain that? And Peter was asking, if it's you, Jesus Christ, please bid me come. Amen. That's the part where it seems what? It doesn't make sense. Amen. So trust in confidence means that you entrust your life to what? To somebody. I was reading an article about, of course, let me just digress a bit. See Ronaldo, I'm sure we all know him. And at the point where his career was about to, it was terminated, and then he learned a new role. Al Nassr is a football club in Saudi Arabia, and they had signed up these stars. What gives them the confidence that in the journey where it's transferring to from that club to another, what if an accident happened? Amen. What would happen? Or what if in the football field and he had a broken leg? What would happen? Why I'm asking this question is because his pay was $75 million a year. It was put, their faith of their bank account were put in the purse of a man, simply because of what? The trust that he can change the football teams. Amen. And he does that. They recorded that they had 884 or so followers. And as at 2 weeks, when they signed him on, their follower rose from that to 11.6 million. Amen. When they were unveiling him, they had over 3 billion views. That's money coming into the account. Amen. So what would have given them the confidence and the trust that, yes, this man will change the narrative of the club? That's what faith does to you. When you begin to take those words and begin to digest it, I am more than a conqueror. Bible says he became poor, that I and you might become what? Rich. How do you explain somebody who's poor and has given you an inheritance in what? In wealth. How do you explain that? Amen. So it takes me back to some of the questions I began to ask. And I began to just pray and just ask. I like to just pray in the spirit that, Lord, Father, rekindle a faith in my heart. Just take a 60 seconds. Just pray, Lord, Father, rekindle that faith, even as small as a mustard seed, in our heart. Let there be a refire. Let there be a reignition in our hearts. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. After I've gone through this, I want to just read the scripture, Isaiah 25, 8 to 9. I want us to just read it together. I have a couple of questions, and I began to ask those questions. Isaiah 25, 8 to 9. I want us to just look at these thoughts. I want to take us somewhere. Isaiah 25, 8 to 9, media, if you can project it for the sake of time. I'm going somewhere. Okay, let's read together. He swallow up debt forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from our faces. The rebuke of his people he will take away from the earth. For the Lord has spoken. The next verse. And it was said in that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. We will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. That's the testimony of Job. He said, when he yet slay me, will I what? Trust him. So do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death? I will fear no evil. Of course, death, the valley and the shadow of death, I like to just imagine. He said, do I walk through the valley and the shadow of death? I will what? Fear no evil. Of course, you're alone, but the Bible is saying you will what? Fear no evil. Amen. So the proof of your trust in God is the confident knowing that, yes, he can never what? Fail. No matter how long it is yet, you could be asking, great man, you might have not understand what I'm been through or what I'm going through. But saying the proof of your trust is your confident what? In God. It's the confident in faith that God's what? Never fails. So can we just go back again and just look at it? Sometimes I began to wonder and say, okay, yes, it's an amazing God. And then for you to trust him, Bible said, there's a scholar that said, the proof of trust, the proof of your obedience is what? The love for God. If you don't love him, you will not obey. He said, keep my commandment and what? And keep my ordinances. Amen. So that's for you to just stand and say, yes, Lord, I will trust you. In the meaning that, yes, there's a particular thing you see in him. And then you are saying that, yes, I will walk through with you again. So another question came to me when I was studying. And I began to wonder, okay, so how can I strengthen my faith? How? Peradventure, maybe you've had it before. Or maybe perhaps you're just even coming there. Or you don't even know how it is like. I want us to just look at Romans 10. I was studying. Of course, faith can what? Be strengthened. How do you explain to Ruth and Anna? How do you explain to Ruth when Oprah was saying that, I've been in this before, and you want me to take another step again? It doesn't make sense. But Ruth was saying, your God will be my what? My God. You've not seen a God before. What gives you the assurance? How do you explain to Anna when she was going to Shiloh back to back for years, and she was trusting God because I'm sure she must have had a word at the back. God is saying, I needed you to bring up what? A Samuel that needs to anoint a king whom you don't even know when he's going to be enthroned. How do you explain that? Amen. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. I want us to just read together. So then faith coming by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. Meaning that faith can be seen and faith can what? Be heard. Amen. So then faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Of course, meaning that how, if you're asking, how do I strengthen my faith? Of course, it's simple there. Faith can be what? Can be heard. And if you decide not to just hear it, you can what? You can see it happen. Of course, Bible has described this Bible for us to be what? A blueprint for every one of us. That's where our faith was transforming. When she was praying, she said, God called for those things that were not as though they were. As you say to a tree, rise and come out of nowhere. Nobody planted it. And God is saying, tree, come out of here. Amen. Hallelujah. So if you needed to strengthen your faith, it's a time that is calling us for this season to what? Begin to study and begin to look down the world. If you ask me again, how do you strengthen your faith? In the place of prayer, of course. Bible says building up your most holy faith, praying what? And the Holy Ghost. How do you pray? How do you explain that? When you began to pray in the Holy Ghost, and then your faith is what? Building. It's rising from 1 to 2 to 3, and it's going there. It's just faith. You can't explain it, but it's coming to us. Amen. I'm talking about how do you what? Strengthen our faith. Of course, I've been there, and I began to wonder, how big is my faith? I like to ask your neighbor, how big is your faith? Amen. And what's your question? What's your answer? Sorry. Let's look at 2 Kings. Sorry, I'm going to just give us some of why I'm saying so, because I began to wonder. Let's look at 2 Kings 6:17. Elijah was telling the servant, because he had worked with him, but yet he was imagining, how can this guy's eyes be blind? Because faith can what? Be seen. 2 Kings 6:17. And Elijah prayed. He does not need to pray now, but he knew that the guy's eyes needs to be opened. And Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eye that he might see, so that his faith can what? Be strengthened. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. And because the Lord knew that this guy needs faith to be strengthened. Of course, we are what? We're men. We say we are God here, what? On earth. I'm still talking about the point, how do I what? Strengthen my faith. And Elijah prayed and said, Lord, please, this guy's faith needs to be strengthened. And he prayed. Do not downplay the role of a prayer. Even when you don't feel like it, just rise up from that your bed. Even when you are tired on that bed, just pray. Like she was saying from the testimony. Many of us said they were trusting God. Meaning even in your heart, when you were looking onto him and wonder, Lord, how is this going to happen? You were praying. Don't look down on yourself. Even when you're wondering, Lord, where is this next miss going to come from? Just trust him. In your heart, Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth what? Speak it. So you have to be very careful what is coming from your heart, because in that thought, you are praying. In that thought, you are praying. In those quiet moments, you are praying, because you are what? You are strengthening your faith. So let's go back to so how much faith must I have if I needed to move this mountain? It's a question for us. I'm just asking, how much faith must I have if I needed to move this mountain? Because of time, I just needed to run. So you're asking, how much faith? Yes, it might be those tears that might strengthen you to the place of prayer and push you to and say, Lord, Father, I've gone through this before. You have done this before. I know this word is for somebody, but I know, God, you can strengthen my faith. It's just about in your word is asking, how much faith was I need to move this mountain? It's just in your word, in your heart. Saying, Lord, I believe you. Lord, I trust you. That's just it. Bible said, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Words and thoughts must have taken you to that point where you began to doubt God. But it's that same word that you can measure those faith. I began to rise from 1, 2, 3, and began to climb the ladder. I'm telling you, God is in the business of doing wonders. Make no doubt. I've come to you because I began to study and began to pray. For months, I've been going through quite a series of journey. You know, how do you explain to a man, like I said, and David was in the backside fighting, and Ziklag had been invaded, and he is coming back to God. Did you know the direction they went? Do you know if he had gone to Lekki or go to mainland? And he was asking, Lord, should I pursue? Will I overtake? And will I recover so that my effort will not be in vain? So, if that part was paused, what would be your response? Of course, I was wondering, and I began to wonder. So, what was David's expectation from God? The Bible says, it said, the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut short. David knew that yet, God has never failed before. How do you explain God's strength to a nation pass through this Red Sea? Of course, Red Sea are not just lagoons. Amen. They are not just gutters of water, and you're saying, yes, let there be a path. But he's saying, go forward. Step your feet. It's just one step. You're asking, how much faith must I need to move this mountain? Can we just rise? Can we just rise? I'll just call you to rise from those ashes and begin to say, Lord, Father, thank you. I know my faith is small, but I don't even need a mustard seed faith again. I just need to trust you. I know, God, even without the mustard seed faith, I know you can do so much more. Can we just begin to pray and say, Lord, Father, I just want to say thank you. Even for you standing, Bible says, I haven't done nothing to stand therefore. The ability to stand where you are shows the proof that God is taking you somewhere. Amen. He said, there's a preacher that said, God will take you through a process of breaking point in order for you to understand the grace to be a champion. If you haven't been through those breaking points, you might not understand where. If you haven't been through this part where you've lost millions, you might not understand where God is taking you, that yes, I need you to be a custodian of wealth. You might not understand when you've been a single mother and God is telling you, yes, I'm raising this child to become what? A God-like heir on earth. But you are saying, Lord, how am I going to do this on my shoulder? But he's saying, yes, put my trust in your heart. Put my word in your heart. Bible is saying, say, thy word would I what? Put in my heart, that my word not sin against you. Of course, we know that yes, sin might be what? Might be that which might limit us. Let me just go back to the scripture again and begin to ask. It was saying, say, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Many times, meaning that most of us has done unpleasantly to God Almighty because of what? A lack of faith. Can we just begin to pray and begin to ask, Lord, Father, please, I thank you for another grace and opportunity, what? To strengthen my faith. Just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Just begin to ask, Lord, Father, thank you for this opportunity to stand before you. Thank you for this monster seed of faith that kept me going. Thank you for this breath in our lungs, knowing fully well you're about to do a new thing. So what? I'm rejected. Yeah, God is saying, oh God, I'm taking you up to a place of what? A process where you now become what? A recruiter of men. Where you become what? A reckoning. Amen. Can we just begin to pray and say, Lord, Father, thank you, God, for renew my heart. Thank you for strengthening my faith. Thank you for, oh Lord, for lifting up my hands, oh God. Father, we thank you. We return all the praise to you. We thank you for your people who has come to you this morning. Lord, we know that, yes, our faith has strengthened. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I'd like you to ask that question in your heart. Just like Anna asked. It was going to Shiloh back to back. And the prophet said, you are drunk, man. He said, no, I'm not drunk. I'm just pouring out my heart. Because I know he's a God that never fails. How do you explain to Zechariah, who had seen God and holy, and you're telling me he will bring forth a child? He will say, no, I've done with kings. And Gabriel will say, did you doubt my word? I am Gabriel that stand right beside God the Almighty, meaning that there's power in this world. Amen. I don't know the word that God has laid in your heart. He said, became poor, that you and I might become what? Rich. I'd like you to just pray. Say, Lord, Father, Lord, thank you for this grace. Thank you, opportunity to renew my faith in you, O God. Father, we give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. We give you all the adorations. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. As I wrap up, I'd like you to just look at that story I shared. For somebody out of a club, they're about to break forth. But for that guy, Ronaldo, it's a build-up of 20 decades of his what? Trust and confidence. He said one thing. He said, anytime I go to the pitch, I know I am the best. Amen. He keeps saying that I know I am the best. And yeah, he was at the verge of where he had retired. When he was given that contract, I read, he said he was the most highest paid player. Who would have thought that his back, when he was hit back down, could bring about coming back to be the best, highest, most player. That situation might just be God wants you to strengthen your faith. Amen. So I'm telling you that, yes, a mustard seed to me now, it seems even bigger compared to God Almighty. When you put things in his hand, trusting God with that faith, he can move what? Mountain. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Let's just begin to bless the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word that has come. Yes, we know that, yes, indeed, it is a perfect faith, but we know that, yes, a mustard seed is what more than a perfect faith. Father, we thank you. We return all the praise to you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Can we just put our hands together for Jesus?